We can sit, right? We can sit. Thank you. All right, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank you and your teacher and your principal for inviting me to speak with you as students and as not only the future leaders of the country, but the current leaders of the country. Because you do not have to be the principal or the member of parliament or a minister or prime minister to think that you are a leader. We are all leaders at the levels that we are in. Okay? So I consider you to be leaders not only of the future, but current leaders today. I always like being in the classroom. I used to be a teacher, as you know, as you may know. I taught at the secondary school in Portsmouth for a couple of years there, and also at the, and now what we call the Dominica State College. So it's always a pleasure of mine to engage students on development, on issues of education, issues of young people, the world, because as you know, the world is a very difficult place now with so many challenges, from terrorism to the ever presence of drugs and in some cases crimes, and with many governments now looking within, meaning only now concerned about their country rather than the world as a whole. And therefore countries like ours have to do more for ourselves by ourselves. Okay? But I've been asked to speak about the role of government in the economy. This is a very extensive and a very broad topic. And we can spend several days and in fact weeks speaking about the role of government in the economy. As you know, this government came into office in 2000. And ever since we came into office, we've been seeking to improve the way of life and the quality of life and the standard of life in Dominica. It has not been easy because, as you know, coming from a family, everything you need, or let's put it say, most things you need cost money. Right? Most things you need cost money. And every demand which the citizens make on the government will cost money. You understand? Because, so even for example, you may have free education, or you may have free healthcare, but it does not mean that it is free to the government that's providing it. You see what I'm saying? So if you go to the hospital and you're under 18, so you don't have to pay for medical care. But it's costing for you to be at the hospital. Medication, doctor's visits, scans and x-rays and the likes. So it's costing you. But I've been asked to talk about the role of government. In the economy. Now, for us to understand the role of government, we have to understand that there are three branches of government. Three branches of government. Can somebody tell me one branch? The executive. So we have the executive, legislature, and three, the what? No, you're wrong. Yes. What's number three? The judiciary, good. All right. But let's take the last one first. The last one is an independent arm of government, meaning the executive has no influence over the operations and the decisions of the judiciary, notwithstanding the fact that it is the executive which provides the financing for the operations of the judiciary. You understand? So the magistrate court, the high court, the OECS Supreme Court, and the Caribbean Court of Justice, that's all part of the Dominica judiciary system. You understand? So when the magistrate sits in court, the government cannot influence his actions or his decisions. He or she is totally independent of the executive. So that's where we go as citizens to allow an independent arbiter to decide on disputes among ourselves as citizens, or if a citizen may have a dispute with the government, or if the police would have charged somebody so the number of matters which go before the judiciary. Now the legislature, what happens there? Huh? Please, I see your faces, you're very bright students, so don't be afraid to talk. Yes, my friend. Laws, what happened there? What laws? What? Laws? That's where laws are passed. So that's where laws are passed. All right? And the legislature, is made up of the 21 elected members of parliament, because we have 21 constituencies, okay? And you have 9 nominated members. And the speaker can be somebody who is elected outside of the 21 or the 9 nominated. So you have the speaker who is not a senator or who is not an elected member. But our constitution allows for a senator to become speaker, or even an elected member to become the Speaker of the House of Assembly. So you have the 21 elected members of Parliament, plus the 9 nominated senators, plus the Speaker, making up the legislature. Now, a lot of the laws which come to the legislature, or all of the laws, as a matter of fact, which come to the legislature, must be approved by the executive first. So it is the executive that really takes and proposes those laws to the legislature. There is debate, and there is a vote. And sometimes the ayes have it, but you can also go to what they call, where you go to a point where you ask for a separation, where every elected member will be called, or every senator will be called to vote. So that's what they call a division, where people actually vote. But most times, the speaker would say, the ayes have it, and I would say, yes, the ayes have it, how do you vote? Yes, or you know, and then the ayes would have it, as always, because the government is the majority. So that's where laws are passed. Now, if a law is passed, for it to be amended, you must go back to the legislature, okay? Now, in respect to the executive, that's where the ministers sit. The executive is made up of the ministers of government. And that's where policies are formulated. So for example, all of you here, from the Kanalago Territory, the Calabashi, and so forth, Marigot and so forth, who you are transported here to school. But you don't pay. The government pays. So it is by a decision of the executive or the cabinet, that's why we have this policy in place. You understand? The creation of the small business unit and providing funding to several small businesses across the country is a decision of the executive. So you're seeing the role of government in the economy. Right? For example, the government has placed $10 million at the aid bank, right, for farmers, and $15 million for tourism And please tell your parents who are farmers, go to the aid bank and try to get some money from there to invest in the farm. Eh? So these decisions here are created by the executive. This is why from time to time, when there is a change of government, you see a different direction is taken. You understand? Because different parties in office will have different philosophical views, will have different ideological views, and will have different interests. You understand? So the eradication of pit latrines, for example, the housing revolution, these are policy decisions. They're not law. They are policy decisions that are taken by the executive to impact the economy. You understand? To impact the economy. Things like the history care program are policy decisions to assist in the reduction of poverty by aiding the senior citizens who are unable to take care of themselves. All of these are policy decisions impacting the economy. For example, the government has indicated, you know, Colgate Palmolive was closed down, where they manufactured soaps in Belfast. And one local investor has decided he's going to buy it. And the government has decided by a decision of the cabinet to provide $2 million to assist with the acquisition of that factory so we can resume the manufacturing of soaps in Dominica. That's a decision of the executive. You understand? So all decisions taken by the executive, every single one of them that are policy decisions can be changed or replaced or terminated by a new government because they are not law. You understand? The decisions taken are not law. They are policy decisions and they are subject to change by any administration. So the government's role in the economy, and because the government is the largest consumer of goods and services in any country, Dominica included, the government has a very critical role to play in the economy. So we're the biggest customer to Domlec, the government. We're the biggest customer to Lime, the government. We're the biggest customer to Duasco, the government. The government buys more groceries than any. They're all families put together. We have to feed the hospital, we have to feed the prison, we have to feed the infirmary. You understand? So the government is the biggest consumer. The government may have the most vehicles at its disposal. So we buy more gas than any other person, any entity in the country. And those monies are passed on to the private sector and allowing them to create jobs in the economy by the government's procurement and policies and so forth. So the government is a major player in the economy of any country, Dominica included. So the difference between the executive and the legislature is that here laws are passed and can only be changed by this body. And in here, in the executive, policies are taken that could be changed at any time with anybody coming in. So this is why, for example, prior to us coming to this government coming to office in 2000, there was no housing revolution. You understand? There was no free health care for everybody 18 and younger and everybody 60 and older. And you know how we came about with the health care from 60 and older, free health care? You know how we came about that? I'll tell you a quick story. I went to the Kalinago territory. Back then it was called the Carib territory. And I was visiting homes. And I met several senior citizens who were sick. On the bed, couldn't get up. But I said to the family, why aren't you taking them to the hospital? You know, everybody calls me Skerrit. That's fine. You know, I prefer people call me Skerrit and so on. And they told me, because we're owing the hospital. And we cannot go back. And I felt as the prime minister of the country, we should not have a system which denies people's people unfettered access to healthcare. The following week, I went to cabinet with a proposal, and I said, with immediate effect, every Kalinago in the country, 60 and over, will have free access to healthcare in Dominica. And 2 years later, the cabinet extended that policy to the whole country. So everybody in the country who is 16 and over and 18 and younger do not pay any hospital bill. Understand? And in addition to that policy decision, we canceled the hospital bills of all those persons who were owing in those categories of ages and so forth. You know how we came about the history care program? I'll give an example. I went to Laplane. So I slept in Laplane that night, and I woke up very early morning, and I went walking in the village. And I came upon a couple, an old couple, they were in the 80s, living together. And the husband was outside with trying to light some wood to make coffee for he and his wife. So I asked the member of parliament, Honorable Seja, are we helping these people? Is government helping these people? Because when I went into the homes were not kept properly. You could see the sheets on the beds were not washed a long time ago. They themselves may not have, the clothes they had was, you know, may have been white originally, but it is black now. And he told me that they're getting public assistance, what people call purpose assistance. So I said to him, but look, these people are getting this money from the government, but I'm not seeing the impact. So we decided now to create a program to send people, pay people, to go to the homes of the senior citizens to take care of them. So to bathe them, to comb their hair, to wash the clothes, to cook for them, you understand? And we decided to call the program, Yes, We Care, so to indicate that somebody cares for our senior citizens in Dominica. So that's how we are able to do it and so forth. The State College, for example, when we came into office, I taught at the State College between 1997 and 1999, all right? 2 years there. And when we came into office, only 7%, listen to me, 7% of all high school graduates in Dominica had access to the college in Dominica. I used to lecture at the college, and I was responsible for the registration of students. And every year, I was charged with a task of registering students. I would register more students than the principal told me to. So the maximum we used to accept every year was 250. And I used to take the number to 270 and sometimes 300 without the principal knowing. Because the students who were turned back, they got the sufficient number of CXCs to enter the college. But the college said, we only have X number of spaces. Lo and behold, as fate would have it, as the good Lord would have decided, I became the Minister of Education a couple years later. And one of my first objectives as the Minister of Education was to do a complete overhaul of the college system in Dominica. That is why in 2002, we created the State College, the Dominica State College. What we did is that we brought all the colleges under one umbrella and create one institution. So we move now from 7% of all high school graduates having access to the college to tell me the number if today is the 9th of March, today, the 9th of March, tell me what's the percentage now. She says 96. My dear friend says 96. a very bright girl. It is 92% today. But what we have done is that we have created by a policy of the government to allow for 100% access. Because we built this new facility, as you may have seen. We've employed more lecturers and more tutors. But for tertiary level institutions, you need to have the basic requirements, entry requirements. So once every single child who completes high school gets the minimum requirements to enter the college, there is a space waiting for you at the Dominica State College. The second point about the policy and the role of the government in the economy and the country, when we came into office, 44% of all primary school graduates had access to the secondary school, which means that 56% did not make it to secondary school. So before we sat the exams, they already knew how many they were taking. You understand? And we introduced in 2005 a national universal access to secondary education in Dominica. And many people have criticized that policy decision. But I stand 100% behind the universal access to secondary education in Dominica, because it has allowed for there to be the exposure of opportunities to all our children. Because I hold a firm view that every one of us is bright. Every one of us has the ability to do well once we apply ourselves to our task. Okay? Once we apply ourselves to the task. So the government, by way of policies, has a major impact on the economy. And my final point to you, because I know at your age, there's an attention span. That's why your periods are 40 minutes, not 60 minutes. Otherwise, you'll be sleeping in class and yawning. And you're thinking of lunch and your nice lunch your mother has for you at home and all these things at this time. The final thing I want to talk to you about, and you've been hearing a lot about it on the radio and television and so forth, is a citizenship by investment program. Now, there are five countries currently in the Caribbean with such a program. The United States of America, which is the world's largest economy, has a program called EB-5, where they grant you a green card if you invest in a project in the United States. Malta, which is part of the European Union, also has a program, citizenship by investment program, whereby an investment in Malta, you are granted Maltese citizenship. Okay? In Dominica, my friends, this program is critical. Critical to the country at this time. It is a major and important source of non-tax revenue for the country. Because the government has very limited ways of generating revenue. And I'll give you the limited ways it has. One, by way of taxes, right? Taxes. Two, loans. Three, grants. And four, sale of assets. Meaning lands, and when the government build homes, they sell the homes, and so forth. Okay? Taxes, many people don't want to pay taxes. Nobody wants to pay taxes. I pay too much tax, I can tell you. And I keep making noise to the government every day, I pay too much tax, you know? So that's where VAT comes in. That's where custom duties. That's where income tax, all right, et cetera, comes in. Loans, the government will take loans from other governments, right? And will take loans from banks, like the Caribbean Development Bank, the World Bank, the IMF, the International Monetary Fund. And we sometimes will take loans from the Dominica Social Security. And then grants is when a country which you have a relationship with or an institution gives you money that you don't have to repay. So it's a gift. Okay? And set up assets, as I told you, we sell houses and we sell lands and so forth. But when you take loans, somebody has to pay for it. And you're only able to pay with loans from the tax revenue. Do you understand? Right? And because most of us do not want to pay taxes, the government has a limited source from this area. And because the world is changing dramatically and economies are having challenges, the source of grants is going down. So compared 10 years ago to now, it is about 60% less. And how do you go about raising funding that is not going to place a burden on the current generations and future generations like yourselves? And the CBI program is a major source of revenue. And you see with the construction of the hotel in Portsmouth, the five-star hotel, that's where we got the money to put in there for farmers. That's where we get money to put for the tourism people. That's where we're getting funds to eradicate pit latrines, to build pit latrines for everybody in Dominica. I can tell you, as the Prime Minister of this country, which is extraordinary, I have the names of every single person in Dominica who needs a washroom in every village. And what we're doing is providing the resources, the money, to build those washrooms for every single person, irrespective of who you are. You understand? The roads, post-Erica, many of our roads got damaged. People's homes got washed away. The government is using funds from the CBI to build those homes and to rebuild the infrastructure. So you can see, my friends, that the government has a far-reaching role in the economy and the welfare and well-being of the society and our country. But as I said to you, because all of these policies are created by the executive, which is made up of the elected government of the day, there is no guarantee that a future government would keep it. And even a future government from the Labour Party itself. You understand? Because after the next election, I'm going to hand over to somebody. You understand? So, you understand? So, but that can change because it is not law. You understand? It is not law. It depends on the ideological thinking of the government. For me, I believe that the government has a responsibility and a duty to help the less fortunate. You understand? People criticize us for that by saying we're giving handouts and so forth. But how do you explain to me? How do you explain to me one's objection to the government going to a village and seeing the condition of somebody's home? And knowing, based on investigation, that person has no means of fixing his home for his family, how do you object to the government assisting that person with a new home? Because for me, I believe that we as Christians, we have a Christian duty, as captured in the Bible, to look after the poor, to look after the less fortunate. So it's not only, government should not focus on big business. on those who already have. We have to ensure that we create a better way of life for everybody, but especially the less fortunate. And that is my commitment. That's my commitment to the country. That's why we have free transportation for you. That's why we provide you with some, many of you, with books and uniform to come to school. That's why we spend millions of dollars sending students to study overseas. That's why, notwithstanding the fact that the college is owned by the government, we pay the tuition fees for many students. That's why, for example, we provide many students with the transportation allowance to pay the bus to go to college every single day, so that they can not only have access to the opportunity, but be able to take advantage of the opportunity. That's very important. I must, I must commend Mr. Stewart for some excellent questions. I also want to tell Mr. Stewart that while I was at grammar school, I was also the head boy there in my time. But the first question, agriculture and so forth. I believe firmly and fundamentally that agriculture is the most important element of our country. You understand? We have tourism, important. Services, important. You understand? Manufacturing, important. But a country must be able to feed itself. You understand? And I believe that there are opportunities in agriculture. One can make money in agriculture if one is serious about agriculture. I can tell you, my friend, that I am also a farmer. I do sell to the supermarkets. I do sell to the hucksters, a wide range of crops. As a matter of fact, this morning I was on the farm for 2 hours in the heavy rains. You understand? So I have a wide range of crops that I sell and so forth. I can tell you I may be the only person who has limes from Portsmouth to Penville now. I have the most lime trees from Portsmouth to things. So I believe in agriculture fundamentally. And this is why we have systematically continued our investments in agriculture, taking into consideration new technologies on the farm. For example, back in, let's say, 10, 15 years ago, yams were seasonal. Today, one can get yams any time of the year in Dominica because of new planting technologies we have passed into the farmers. We have a number of concerns in agriculture that will affect agriculture. One is the cost of labor. Labor is very high. When you compare the cost of labor in Dominica to Ecuador, for example, it is about 20 to 1. When a farmer has to pay a laborer, let's say, $40 or $45 or $50 for a day, now a day means 7 to 11. It is a huge cost on any small farmer in a country like Dominica. You have another issue there, of predator larceny. By the time a farmer plants something before it's ripe, somebody's stealing it from him. So it's a major matter to us and so on. And this is why we are not ruling out, from the government standpoint, setting up a court to deal specifically with predator larceny to ensure we can put a stop to it. What the other issue you have is pests. For example, back in the 70s, 80s, 90s, you had yellow sigatoka, what they call leaf spot. Now you have black sigatoka, which is more dangerous and deadly than yellow sigatoka. So you have a number of things confronting farmers, but there are a number of opportunities. With the presence of more hotel rooms in Dominica, currently and in the very near future, for example, in Portsmouth, you'll have 160 rooms with one hotel, a five-star. So you have opportunities here for the expansion of the domestic market. There's also a high demand for agricultural produce in many of the countries within CARICOM. St. Kitts, Anguilla, Antigua, Guadeloupe, Martinique, all of the islands require a high volume of agricultural exports and imports. For the future of agriculture to be sustained, people like myself and yourself, as young people, must be more actively involved in agriculture. Because our parents who were involved are now 70s, you understand? And they still go to the farms. The question is, when they pass on to another life, who's going to replace them? And that's why you see sometimes some farms are abandoned. The father was very hardworking. He built his house on the farm. He bought his vehicle every 5 or 7 years from his farm. He sent his children to school. But none of the children want to go on the farm. So he has 7 acres that are not productive. So we have to ensure we get more young people on the farms. What we're seeking to do in the government is to set the infrastructure. This is why we have the pack houses, where the farmers bring their produce. The government buys it. The government packages it. And the government also assists with the export to markets of the agricultural produce. Okay? We have 2 packing houses, one in Roseau, one in Portsmouth. We're also providing direct financial support to farmers with the 10%, with $10 million at 3% interest with a 6 month grace period. Prior to this facility, we had loans at the aid bank where one loan was 0%, another was what they call 50-50, where if the farmer took 30,000, he got 15 free from the government and the other 15 at 2% from the government. To provide farmers with the cash they need to invest in the farm and make investment on the farm much cheaper for the farmers. We're now constructing some 15 feeder roads across Dominica. And in the next financial year, we'll commence construction improvements to another 12 to allow for more access to the farms. I have been in the last 2 years, 3 times to Vauxhall in Marigot, 3 times to the farm there, to see the condition of the other roads and to ensure that we could address the concerns of the farmers in respect to improving that farm road in Marigot and so forth. I'm sure you'd have seen the new Bailey Bridge that was built by the government there in Vauxhall to allow a better crossover on the river and so on. A substantial investment there. So the future of agriculture, in my respectful view, my brothers and sisters, is that it is bright. But it can only achieve that brightness if we as Dominicans commit ourselves to it. And a lot of us, for example, we have the abattoir, and farmers are selling to the abattoir. But if we continue buying imported chicken from the United States and Brazil, we have a problem. We have lots of fruits in Dominica, but very few of us have the time to squeeze the grapefruits. It is easier for us now to go and buy the juice in the supermarket. So all of this are coming from overseas. So we have to make a commitment as citizens to consume what the farmers grow in Dominica. You understand? Because when we do that, we're helping create jobs and we're helping the farmer see a positive return on his farm. The reason why you cannot put a ban on imports, except for health reasons, is because we are part of some international trade arrangements. You understand? From the WTO, the World Trade Organization agreement. So you cannot arbitrarily impose hindrances to conducting trade among countries in the world. What we have done is that we have able to put import duties on it to seek to make it a little more expensive to deter us from buying what is imported as opposed to what is produced here in Dominica. So that's an issue. Yeah, thank you. That's an issue there and so forth. So agriculture, the future agriculture is bright, I believe so, because we'll always need to eat. But it's first order business here is for us to consume what we produce in Dominica. In terms of science, this is why we open up opportunities for students to access higher education. And we have not limited students' ambition. We have allowed students to decide for themselves what their interests. Some of them we are able to guide them into particular areas. You understand? By provision of scholarships to them and requisite support. This is why, for example, we have a Center of Excellence in ICT at the State College, a joint partnership between the government of Dominica and the government of India. Because what we want to have, my friend, Mr. Stewart, is not just people who know how to use a computer, but we want our students to be able to develop apps and patent them and sell it and make money. You understand? To create software, programs so that we become now innovators rather than just consumers of innovation. And with the Center of Excellence, that's where we're moving to. So we can create our own cartoons in Dominica, our own images in Dominica, and possibly one day see one of us from our country on the international scene as a major innovator in our country and so on. So that's why I see science going, being more innovative. And we are setting the platform in the school system to provide that opportunity, those opportunities for our students. Regards to vision for Northeast, and I take it when you mean Northeast, you mean the whole of the Northeast and so forth. I believe that the Northeast, we have some of the most hardworking people in Dominica, in office. And some of the brightest in Dominica come from the Northeast. And what we need in the Northeast, in my respectful view, are leaders who can extract from us, pull out from us, those positive energy, those positive skills and talents that we have, and let us be positive about our way of life rather than being negative all the time. Because if we only speak about negative things, we will start doing negative things. And to whose benefit? Or who will it destroy when we do that? So we have to have a more positive outlook from ourselves. And the leadership in those communities must provide that environment where we do not see ourselves as being separated from the rest of the country. You understand? We need to come together and to consolidate those talents and energy. I mean, when you look at a community like Marigot, for example, in my respectful view, if everybody in Marigot will come together, those who live in Roseau, those who live in Mao, those who live in West Hill, come together in Marigot. Marigot can be the most productive, the most successful community anywhere in the world. Because you have hardworking people there. You have respectful people there. You have people who have held agriculture, you know, up in the country. Bright people, various talents, from engineers to doctors to lawyers in there. But what we need is for us to look at how we can use those talents and skills to the benefit of the people. I give you the assurances that there will be a new state-of-the-art hospital in Marigot to serve the Northeast. I give you the assurances that this government is doing everything possible to build an international airport here in the Northeast. You understand? And you will be the first time saying so, because I've not said so to the country before, that we have in fact engaged an international firm, an American firm, to do all of the studies in relation to the international airport. And they're coming down to do a presentation to the cabinet on the 21st of April, 2017, on their findings. You understand? So, I see the Northeast, and you have the airport with night landing, the extension of the services, and so forth. So, I see the Northeast, and with the hotels coming to Portsmouth, you mustn't only see the Northeast as your marketplace. You understand? The whole country must be seen as a marketplace. There's a young boy, for example, and just to tell you the resourcefulness of people. The young boy from Marigot, and I buy a lot of coconut water from him. I can't remember his name, Son or whatever his name, I think they call him by the nickname Son or whatever it is. But he bottles coconut water. You understand? He has a little bus, and he goes around the country selling it, and so forth. For the Carnival, I must have bought about 60 bottles from him, and so forth. Big bottles. So we have to use our God-given talents to see how we can make life better, first for ourselves and our family, secondly for the community, and thirdly for the country. So so my vision for the Northeast is that I see the Northeast as positioning itself as playing a major role in the country's economic and social development. But that will only be achieved, my dear brothers and sisters, if we start thinking positively about our communities and about our country, and that we do not see, because one of the fundamental errors, my dear friends, that many leaders in the office have, I'll leave this with you, my final point is that they see me solely from the lens of partisan politics. So they see me as the prime minister solely as the leader of the Labour Party, and not as the prime minister, because there are two distinctions. And we have to work with the government of the day to make life better for us. But if we do not want to engage the government, then how are we going to work together to make life better for us? Because the government is important. Irrespective of who the government is, it's important for us to work together and so forth. So I'm hoping that you can be the shining light and provide that kind of youth leadership and positive leadership that's required and so on. And by your questions, the future of the North East is certainly very, very bright, because those questions are well thought of questions and so forth. Business startup, what we do with businesses quickly, we provide them with a wide range of concessions. Secondly, we provide them with direct financing. From the small business unit, they get grants, so not loans. And what we have done now, with placing monies at the aid bank at highly concessionary rates to small businesses, they're able to make investment cheaper for them. Because prior to the 3% loans, when we came into office, loans were 11% at the aid bank, 12%. Over time, we brought it down to 6%. And now, we brought it down to 3% and 2% for some facilities. So you can see the difference between 12 and 2. That's 10% percentage points difference, which makes now investment for the small persons cheaper. You understand? What people must do in small businesses is that they must manage it properly. You understand? And sometimes they buy things which they do not need. So you see a man is doing well with a small business, then he has 5 motor cars. You understand? He's expanding himself and creating liabilities on the business that are not bringing any profit to the business and so forth. So, with respect to port charges and so forth, obviously, some of them enjoy duty-free. So whatever they bring in, they don't pay taxes on it. But it can be a concern for small businesses in some cases, because there are some items and there are some products that we do not extend duty-free concessions to. And so that when a person brings it in with already an imported price, price of inflation, and you add the duties, it can be pretty expensive and so forth. So vehicles in particular, and because the taxes are compounded, you understand what I'm saying? So you may have 40% on a vehicle duty. VAT is 15%, and excise tax is 28%. And it's something I'm looking at to see how we can change, right? 28%, right? So your vehicle is 10,000. So that's the customs valuation. They put the 40,000 on that 10,000. Then they put the 15% on that 10,000 plus the 40%. You know what I'm saying? And then they put the 28% on the 10,000 plus the 40%. I spoil your marker there. Sorry. Plus the 15%, plus the 28%, and then they give you your stuff and so on. What are we seeking to do, Mr. Stewart, is to see whether we can have the 40% on the 10,000, have the 15% on the 10,000, and have the 28% on the 10,000. And that will certainly reduce, in my respectful view, the cost of business in our country in so far as port taxes are concerned. With regards to how many times I have visited Marigot, I have been to every single cranny in Marigot, from fine grass to Monkey Hill, and their names I cannot call inside there because they were, you know. I've been there all along. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you. Some years ago, I visited Monkey Hill, or North End. And when I went there, and I saw where the source of water was coming from, it's an old concrete slab covered with all sorts of trees and moss and all these things and so on. But I said, well, how could the people get the water from this area? And there was a project that was earmarked for my village, where I live, Vickers. And I decided to push back the improvement to the water system in Vickers and divert the money to North End Water Project. And that's how North End ended up getting its water project back in the days and so forth. So I've been to Marigot many times. I have many friends there. I visit people there. I visit some senior citizens there. I have been to funerals there, though most Catholic funerals are held in Wesley. So when I come to funeral, instead of being in Marigot, the funeral in Wesley, because that's where the cemetery is in the Catholic Church. So I've been to numerous funerals of people there. I'm in touch with many people in there. From the airport, sometimes I stop and say hi to people who I know. I understand. At present, the council has $300,000 to go towards the washroom program. We will send some money very soon for some roads in Marigot to be improved. You understand? There's some roads in Marigot to be improved. We've started plans for the new hospital. But there must be a willingness on the part of the leadership of the community to be more positive and productive. So in terms of my visit and so forth, and I see where the question is coming from. And I'll tell you, I want to leave you with my final point on this. I want you to dispel any notion that has been inculcated in your minds that myself or this government doesn't like Marigot people. That is foolishness. That is total nonsense. This is not true. It's not true whatsoever. We have nothing negative about Marigot. As a matter of fact, I can tell you, all of the times I've visited Marigot, not at one time anybody has been disrespectful to me. They're very respectful people in Marigot. Maybe one or two people who are troublesome and so forth. But by and large, Marigot people are respectful, cultured people. Understand? But you have to guard against people giving the world the impression that Marigot people are hostile people. You are not a hostile people. You are respectful people. All right? Yeah, that's it for me. Okay.